My name's Duncan MacBean, as you know, and I've been teaching for some time now. I started teaching in Swindon. I taught there for 6 years, and since then I've been teaching the Prince Wales School for 25 years now. So that's some time. So 31 years teaching, 25 years here. I've been really lucky to have worked here. I've really enjoyed it. I still continue to really enjoy being here. My children came to the school. They're all grown up now, and I've actually got a grandson who's starting in reception now, just this week. So yeah, I've had quite a lot of long association with the Prince of Wales School, and I've loved it. So I've been really happy here, and I suppose the first thing to say is how important I would consider the happiness of your children. Priority number one, really, particularly in light of all the confusion and strange things that happened last year, making sure that they're happy and that they have a robust mental health, and that school is a real joy for them, is our absolute priority. So if at any point you feel that their happiness isn't being addressed, or they're not happy for some reason, please come and get in touch with us straight away, and we'll endeavour to make sure that they are. I do think that the joyfulness of primary education and the joy of the children and that whole sense of well-being and that positive attitude towards learning is absolutely key, and it if you build good foundations of that, it goes a long way in for the rest of your time in education. So we're right on that. I guess probably in light of the fact that we now have to kind of do slightly more formal routine type things like hand washing and lining up and marching across areas without mixing with other children, that routines are as important, if not more important than ever. And we do have quite a strong regime on, quite a strict regime on washing hands before and after events, and every time we go in and out, and we've got the sanitising your hand stations that I'm encouraging children to use. You might have noticed, or you might have heard, actually, rather than noticed, but you might have heard that I've got the children very much in their working places. So the children have their own desks and they're kind of like work groups. They might change over the course of time, but the reason for that is it's really a time-saving thing, really. So they come in, we're using up a bit of time with hand washing, etc. So it's really important that they know exactly where they got to go. And the books and things that I've got colour coded, it's just so that I can put all the red books out on the table, and things can happen nice and quickly. Right, the curriculum then, starting with maths. Maths is the first lesson every day, starting with power maths. And at the moment, we are doing a big push using our power maths scheme. Which you might see looks like this. These pages here that are in this book are actually, I tend to use the computer to show these pages, and I work through various sections with the class before they then go off and apply that in their own practice books. You've seen something like this last year. Last year's were yellow, the year one ones. But the idea is that they have sort of three pages go with each lesson. So at the moment we're doing lots of work on place value, a really key thing in maths development, and using lots of manipulatives to sort of reinforce that, and the idea that they can actually see the numbers. So lots of things like Dean's Cube. So here's 32, and we might be using these sorts of things as well, place value cards, to show how numbers work together. So there's lots and lots of ways of doing that. Kind of like the same thing, but reinforcing, getting a really good, using number lines, a really good understanding of the number system and how it works. Some of these as well, these sorts of counters. So representing numbers in lots of different ways. So any sort of support that you can give at home with maths, obviously that's great. But the idea of being able to sort of visualise it and see it in picture form, or actually representing with equipment, manipulatives as we sort of call them, and then drawing things and then explaining things and really going into depth. So our focus over the next 10 lessons is numbers up to 100, and then we've got another 10 lessons after that, which is addition and subtraction, and then there's a block on money, which again is about 10 lessons, and then After that, there's a slot on multiplication and division. So it's quite sort of, you know, a lot of what you call number work in the first block. There's three of these. Each one of these lasts approximately a term. And then in the other terms, you're covering other areas of the maths curriculum, like data handling and shapes and those sorts of things that come in a later time. So that's maths, and as I say, that's first lesson every day. There's an hour on that, and usually when the children come in, there's maths out on the table for them to get on with. It may be that, you know, I've got a basket with various equipment in that we would encourage them to use. Okay, so moving on from maths, the next thing possibly to talk about is literacy, or the next lesson is literacy. Let's break that into bits. Obviously, it's really important that we do this. Let's talk about reading first. So we're using various strategies to help children learning to read. They're in groups according to ability to some extent. Obviously, within the class pod, they're staying with the same children that are in their class when they do this. So they're not mixing with other classes. So we have various strategies that we use. And the bulk of the children in the class are working with me, doing a class reading text, and we'll follow the same text over the next sort of few weeks. Really get into detail, into depth, with a quite sophisticated text that they'll need support with. At the moment, we're doing James and the Giant Peach, which may be a text that some children have come across, but as I say, they haven't sort of done it with me in the detail that we're doing it. So hopefully, they'll enjoy that, and we'll cover different texts throughout the year. Other groups, so there are some children that are still working on the Read-Write Ink phonics scheme, so they're in various sort of structured progressive reading scheme, and they'll finish that. They're doing that with Mrs. Bernard, and they'll work on that for hopefully by Christmas they'll be ready to sort of move into the same books as the rest of the class. There are other children that are having a slightly different menu. We're using this book, Development of Spelling, and it's the same groups, the same children in the same groups are using this. And this is a very nice structured scheme which looks at different spelling patterns each approximately week. So each unit lasts a week. The first unit in this book is how the OR sound is spelt with the letter A when it comes before L or double L. It's typical English language things, complicated as it is. Don't know how that compares to Greek, by the way. Greek might be phonically logical, but as we know, the English language is fraught with complications. So this is sort of the next stage up from the phonics, really. It's that having got the idea of the phonics, this kind of is this the exception bit, the bit where you need a bit of extra knowledge to understand quite how it fits with English. So there's a different sort of idea each week, and you might have noticed that I've been sending home spelling lists, which are kind of the words that we're doing during that unit. So that's just so that you're aware. Like, the children kind of like the idea that these are the words we're doing, and I'll do a bit of sort of flashcards, and they'll have a go with their whiteboards at practicing and writing them down. And at the end of the week, I do give them a little test type thing. It's only a bit of fun, really, but they do like to do that. So I'm going to make sure those words go home each week. It'll look a bit like that. The Mrs. Bernard's group will have one that's got different words on, but it'll look very similar to that, depending on which group they're in. And there are some other children with other words too. On the subject of things going home, possibly mention now about home learning. Home learning is going to be given out, if you like, on Friday. It'll probably come out on a piece of paper that looks something like this. This is the last week's, about leaves. And I'll blog that as well, so that'll always go out on the blog. And I will always do a home learning on the Friday that kind of encouraging the children to have had a go at it by the following Friday. So it sort of runs for a week. Obviously, doing it over the weekend and handing it on Monday is great, but if you know, you've got a busy weekend and you don't get to do it, and you've got the rest of the week. And if it doesn't happen and you don't do it for any reason at all, there's no pressure on that. Nobody's going to be sort of expected to hand your homework in. It's sort of an optional thing. really just to encourage learning, and children sort of enjoy it. And certain times they'll be really enthusiastic, and certain other things they might be busy that week or have other things on. That's absolutely fine. But as I say, I will keep that as a routine that runs Friday to Friday. Talking about spelling and reading, accelerated reader is a scheme that we're using still. For most of the children, we'll be able to access a text and then take a quiz about that text at having read the book. We are in the process at the moment of giving the children what's called a star reading test, which will give them a score that equates to what book level they get from the library. So if they get a score of 1.5, then they'll be encouraged to read books around that level from the basket in the library. And we're going to let that run, pretty much as and when. Children can access it all the time at home. You'll have books at home that will be on the accelerator reader scheme. Lots of books are now on the scheme, and it just provides a bit of, I guess, incentive for them to read the book and then have a little test about it, and they can collect points and they can sort of win little virtual prizes. There's more detail about the accelerated reader scheme in the newsletter that went out, so I'm not going to expand on that too much, but do the newsletter that went out just to talk about how that works. And we'll make sure the children in school, in the school week, have the opportunity to go and change their book in the library. They'll also be able to get a library book as well, which is kind of a reference book that they'll be able to take out. We're kind of in the early stages of that yet, because not all of the children have taken the accelerated reader test yet. Some of them haven't got it quite up and running. So that's kind of literacy. Well, the thing about literacy, obviously, the importance of writing. So I'm really keen that the children write every day. So there may be a theme that following through the week. Last week we wrote a story about a little girl who had an accident when she was playing in the park. There's a sequence of pictures, and they were supported in developing a story on that. This week we're doing a piece of writing about Victorian children and what a hard life some Victorian children have, having to work in coal mines and as chimney sweeps and things like that, which they're finding quite interesting. So that's the theme for this week. So each week there will be a kind of a writing theme that we'll go over a few lessons. At the same time as that's happening, every day I would encourage the children to do some handwriting practice. This is an example of a handwriting book. So I will put some letters down the side using the joins here, and I'll be giving them a quiet sort of 5-10 minutes every day to practice their handwriting. And I try to pitch that at the individual child, really, because obviously I write the bits for them to copy at the side. So if some children need a bit more support, maybe I'll make single letters, and some children are really getting the hang of joined up writing, I might write whole words, and they literally just have to copy that. So that's an exercise in presentation. I think that's probably covered literacy. I've probably forgotten something, but come back. Literacy does tend to use topics that coincide with our science and our humanities, possibly RE too. So we tend to be the topics for the written work are likely to be things that are topical to other subjects that we're covering, which I'll come into now actually. So science, we've started off, obviously we just had the home learning about leaves. It doesn't particularly fit in with what we're supposed to be doing in year two. And the reason for that is because we need to cover some of the things that didn't really happen in enough depth at the end of the summer term. So at the end of the summer term in year one, the children would have been doing more about plants and the parts of plants and including trees, and looking at naming different things and working out how things work. So that's the reason why we're sort of backtracking a little bit. So I'm doing a bit of work this half term about plants and trees, and then our other science will be covering sort of experimental using and applying type aspects of science, where there'll be sort of investigation set up of various types. We've got a STEM week coming up as well, we don't know too much about ourselves yet, but it's going to be involving the Arctic and all sorts of investigations about flying machines and things like that. And also this term before Christmas, the children in their science will cover a bit of work about the human body and how we stay healthy and healthy diet and things. So there's a bit of a mixture, partly because we're trying to catch up on some things that were missed. Science is something that we do every week, and it's usually a discrete lesson for an afternoon. It might be that I'll do two science lessons in 1 week so that there's some more time for practical activity as well. On the subject of topics, so the science topics I've mentioned, the humanities topics, this term there's a focus on history and the Victorians. And I'm doing the Victorians, if you like, from the view of a child living in Victorian times. But I'm also doing it from a local perspective because we're going to be finding out about the railway line that went from Upway to Abbotsbury, which was basically a Victorian concept. It was built in the Victorian era, and it was redundant and not needed by the 1950s, and it's not there anymore. So, but we'll be looking at where it went and little examples of little marks that it's left on the landscape. We're looking at some of the railway sheds that are still there, and there's a railway station that's now somebody's house, and there's little bits of the railway line that you can find if you know where you're looking. So we're doing a Victorian industrial revolution topic, but centering it around a local thing, the railway line, which was obviously a steam trains used to use it originally, and then we can talk about all that sort of thing and how a little microcosm, if you like, of the industrial revolution, Upway and Abbotsbury. So it's quite an enjoyable topic. Hoping to take them on a trip to see that. Which we're hopefully before the end of the month. We still haven't booked many buses yet, but that's in hand, hopefully. Computing, we're going to be doing work relating to coding, which is basically following instructions and being very specific about how you give details and build things. And we'll be using the Purple Mash scheme for that, which is quite a sequential and easy to follow scheme, and the children can make things move and make things move into certain places and direct things using obviously very specific instructions. Also looking a bit at spreadsheets nearer Christmas. That's computing. What else haven't I mentioned? Oh, I suppose after we've done the Victorians and nearer Christmas, we're going to be thinking about world climates and where different foods come from according to climates, and where how food gets to our table, and you know where it comes from. So there's kind of a bit of geography related to world geography, related to climate, related to food that comes from these different places. So that's a sort of little block that we'll be doing before Christmas. I won't go into any more detail about that. Our RE topics are this half term is going to be about Islam, more specifically about how Muslim people worship. And after half term, that we're going to be looking at essentially the Christmas story, really, and how the New Testament, the beginning of the New Testament, talks about how the birth of Jesus, and how Christians celebrate Christmas in different parts of the world. So that's kind of how that works. Art and DT, again, this is a nice part of the curriculum that the children are enjoying. We'll be going, we link a bit of that, in fact, with our humanities topic. So we're going to be creating some binker sewn railway steam engines. And they're going to sew the shape onto some binker. Possibly make those into calendars, actually, which was what we did last year. We're going to be looking at pictures of steam trains. So there's some nice ones by Lowry that we'll be looking at, and there's some nice pictures by Monet of the station, some stations in France where you get the Impressionist pictures. And we're going to be looking at, from a technical point of view, at the idea of perspective, where looking into the distance. So obviously a railway line is quite a good way of showing perspective. As the line gets further away, it gets smaller, that sort of thing. So, that's part of that. That'll be our art. We're art and DT covering those areas. So how I've talked. I've talked for 20 minutes. I'm not quite sure whether there's anything else I particularly need to cover, so I'm kind of open to questions, really. I see there's four of you there. Welcome, by the way. Hello. Is there anything that you'd like to ask me? Mr. Spackland, I'm not sure whether I'm asking people want to ask me questions. Am I going to be able to hear them?
Yeah, you should be able to hear them.
I've got a question. I feel like I should video. Can you hear me? It's Rebecca.
Yeah, I can. Hi there.
I feel like I should do video because it just feels unfair. Oh, is that one not there? There I am.
Hi there.
Thank you for that. I just had a question about accelerated reader.
Yeah.
So we've been encouraging Rufus to do it.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't say he finds it an incentive. Usually he just wants to read the next book.
Okay.
So it's useful to show that he's comprehended it.
Yeah.
But how important, if it's not acting as an incentive, how important is it for us to encourage him to do that? Or is it useful for you?
It's definitely useful for us because obviously we can track all sorts of things. We can track not only what he's been reading, but also the fact that he's got a certain comprehension. In terms of the incentive, I think you might find that now he's back at school and there's kind of a bit of a buzz about it. And the other children are talking about it and we're kind of whipping it up a bit that he might get a bit more incentive. I've experienced that with other children, actually, where they're often children who are very good readers. They're not that bothered because they're really into reading for reading's sake anyway. So it tends to be children that are a little bit more reluctant. And I dare say it tends to be boys, but where you just need to sort of keep them going, jolly them along. And it's a bit of incentive like that. So,
okay,
I think in answer to your question is probably keep it going for a bit because there are some advantages, but also not to worry too much because it is there as a sort of a scaffold or support, really. So if it's not really work, if it does not really need it as a scaffold and support, then that's great because you're doing it anyway. So yeah.
Okay.
We'll keep
going with it.
Yeah,
and
cool.
Then.
Yeah. Actually, there was another question. Another thing that I should perhaps have mentioned that I hadn't. The phonic screening test is something that the children do when they're in year one. They've got to be all the children in year two. Basically, have got to do the phonic screening test. We've got to do it at the end of October. It's a government sort of tracking system. And children need to pass their phonics screen test. So just so we may be aware, that will be happening. I don't think the children will be that aware that they're doing it. They have to go out and do it individually. And I probably will have to spend a bit of time with particularly some of our more able children who are good at reading, because some of the words that they have to read aren't words, so they're going to look at them and go, well, you know, what does that doesn't say anything type thing. So to be aware of that. And the other thing I was kind of anticipating people might have asked about is the SATs at the end of year two. And as we understand it at the moment, SATs is going to be kind of happening as it did, obviously not last year but the year before, so it'd be back to normal. But those sorts of things do change fairly quickly, so I don't know. We'll wait and see on that one.
Well,
thank you for your question about accelerated reader, though. I know what you mean. It has different impacts on different children, but it's good that he's really enjoying his reading. He's really keen.
He's really keen.
He was showing me his was it not Beast Quest? Was it? It was something similar there.
He's really
enjoying his reading, which is great. And you know, if it's, as I say, if it's not really necessary to use as a scaffold, that's just basically a good thing, really. But it's there anyway. So
okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Have we got any other questions? I haven't done this on Zoom before. I often have screens to show people, which I haven't this time because I wasn't sure I'd be able to cope with handling, you know, this like this and moving things around. But I hope that's been useful. I mean, the thing to say really is if you do have any concerns, please email me. Do get in touch and make sure, you know, as like I said at the very beginning, the happiness of your children is number one priority, and, you know, their joy of their learning, absolutely right at the top of the list, along with obviously the safety. But I do think that, you know, if they're safe and happy and they're kind of enjoying the whole experience, that the learning is so much easier at that time. Anyway, if you're happy to leave it there, if you've got no more questions, I shall say goodbye. And I should probably have to leave this on until Mr. Spackland sorts it out. But do get in touch if there's anything else you need to know. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Mr. Spracklin, are you going to help me with this?